Well, hello again, everyone. Welcome to another Horizon episode. We currently have the Hangar 9 Carbon Cub 15cc sitting here, which has been a separate build I've been doing. I've been titling it My First ARF. We'll put a link to that in the description below if you want to learn more about that. But we've been kind of teasing the guys that have been following that series that we were going to do a video on ironing. And now that everything's basically together and visually looks pleasing, we're going to go ahead and run through a video. And we want to make sure you guys know that this isn't just for this plane. This applies to a lot of stuff. This is going to be like an evergreen video for you guys to watch for many years. So brought in Ali, as always, the expert here. And we've got some tools you're going to need for doing this. So Ali, if you want to kind of run through that and get rolling here.
Yeah, ironing, as Kyle said, basically not our shirts, not our pants, it's the airplane. As you can see, a lot of people have picked up on videos that we've posted earlier that the surface finish isn't perfect, right. Far from it, it's wrinkly. That's not a detriment of the material, that's not the way it's built, it's a humidity thing. Just a quick background why these things wrinkle and why you're seeing that. Mm-hmm. The covering is a plastic material, it's airtight. The material underneath is balsa and plywood.
Right.
Now, balsa and plywood naturally has some humidity within it. Comes from an environment in Southeast Asia where humidity is a lot higher than here. And even the journey across from the vendor to here, it will go through so many different humidity changes, temperature changes. The reason why we didn't iron, I told Carl not to iron straight away, is let the wrinkles come out. You know, you've taken it from out the box, which is all sealed and everything like that. It's sat in a container, it was made in Southeast Asia. You imagine all those different temperature and humidity changes. Let it breathe, let it settle, let all the wrinkles come out, and then we'll tackle it.
I'm thinking even from sitting in the warehouse too to being in a climate controlled area is also same thing.
And every plane does it. You know, some people say, oh, it's a poor building or manufacturing standards. It's not. Any ARF will do it. If it doesn't, you need to think why, you know, because the humidity stays the same. That's right. Almost impossible. So don't sweat it. They all come out. There's techniques, there's hints, right. There's tips, there's little tricks of the trade that make it easier. Little things we can show you that will make it a lot more difficult if you don't follow a course of action. So yeah, hopefully that's what this video can cover.
Yeah, and one thing that we're kind of fortunate that we had Ali next door. We did not put in any of the window material, and that
was the lights.
Or the lights, correct.
The light covers.
And that was a lot to just prevent, you know, damaging that surface. So
it's one of the hints and tips. You've got a thin plastic glazing here, very thin plastic glazing here. Mm-hmm. If I start going at this area around here to get rid of this wrinkle, that wrinkle, that wrinkle with a heat gun, it's pretty obvious you're going to damage that.
Now you have a new problem.
Exactly. Now, this ironing isn't a one-stop deal. You know, you may have to do this a number of times. Right. Again, whilst the humidity stabilizes, when you go out flying in the middle of summer and the humidity level is up at like 90%, and then you bring it back to an air-conditioned workshop. Right. In those cases, when the glass is applied, or the glazing is applied, you just have to be careful in the area, because I'm not going to suggest you peel it all off. But certainly for this initial shrink, it's better to have all of the fragile bits off. I mean, you could even have the cowling off if you wanted to, because the hot air gun, by nature, gets hot. So if you go at that area there, you could damage the fiberglass. Just be aware of that. It's just a heads up. And the same with the smaller bits of trim as well. They take a different attitude, as it were, to high heats. You can put a high heat on this big piece of silver or this piece of yellow quite easily and quite well, but some of the little trim bits on the side, if you go at that, don't be surprised if it peels back or actually changes shape.
Okay.
So have that in mind when you're going at areas. Same with the decals on the fin, or if you have the end numbers, they're a different material as well. So always have that in mind. Basically, think before you shrink. Just look at the area you're going at. Don't, just go with a hot air gun and expect everything to be the same. So, have that in mind. And on that subject, hot air gun, you keep hearing me talking about it. It's not a paint stripping gun. Whilst it's not a hair dryer, it's not a paint stripping gun.
Okay.
They're your two temperatures. Hair dryer goes on your hair, obviously it gets to hot, but not hot enough to shrink this stuff.
Okay.
Paint stripper heat gun will burn your hair off just as it will melt a hole in this.
Okay.
There are dedicated, specific tools for this job. Same applies to the iron. You've got a domestic iron for ironing our shirts and our pants.
Right.
They're a little bit cumbersome for, and you can do it. I've seen people cover it, but yeah. One, the wife doesn't get too happy when she's got yellow and silver on the base of the iron. Two, it's big and cumbersome. So bear that in mind. If you can get the specific tools for the job, it makes it a lot easier. If you can't, any modeler who's been in this game for a while will have these tools. Borrow them if you can.
Right.
They're available. Everything that we're showing you today that we're using is available from Horizon Hobby or tau.com. So yeah, it's go out and get it. It's well worth it. It makes the job easier and the end result much better.
We'll put the links to that stuff too below as well. That way if you're unfamiliar with it or you're going to see it and be like, well, which thing was that? It'll all, you know, you can match up the pictures with what's on the website. So
these are the tools of the trade. So primary two tools, the heat iron, sealing iron, all different names for it, and the hot air gun.
Okay.
They are two main devices. We have this little device here, which is a trim sealing tool or a trimming iron.
Okay.
Same principle as this bad boy, but a much smaller heated area. Okay. This is ideal, not essential, okay? By all means, if you're gonna have to choose one device, it would definitely be this one. This is more for those little areas. You know, you wanna get in here and do those little corners, or you wanna get in hinge gaps. This is great for that. But you can make do with this, so it's your choice. Just be careful, this bad boy gets really hot, and because it's a small area, if I put it there, I'll burn a hole through it. Okay, so bear that in mind when using the trim. It's only meant for edges, like on a hard surface.
Okay.
The heat iron, you may notice, has a, what we call a heat sock or an ironing sock on the base here. That's intentional. You can use it without, by all means. What this does, it gives a barrier between the hard metal base of the iron and the pretty, I wouldn't say delicate, but the covering material, which if you're going at it really hard with the hard metal base, you can mark it, you can score it. This is just a protective device, which is this thing here. Crazy cheap, really, really simple. Just goes over here and protects it. Worth, if you're ordering one, order a couple, because they do, as you notice, they get marks on them, the color transfer and so forth.
Is that something you'd switch between each plane or just kind of when warranted?
Yeah, well, no, when warranted. You'll get a few planes out of this, depending how hard you press, how hot you get, and how much area you've got to cover. So it's definitely worth having a spare. It's one of those devices or those items that you go to do a covering job and you burn through, say, and it stops you from going ahead. Like I say, you can do without it. Just be aware of what you're doing. You know, you're putting a metal device on shiny surface. If you go and press really hard, you're likely to score or scuff. So if you've got no sock on it, just go lightly.
Okay.
The hot air gun, like I said to you, cables everywhere. it's not a hairdryer. Do not put it near your hair. It will, it will do more of a mess than my hair is, trust me. But at the same time, it's not as hot as a paint stripper. Having said that, if I get it on the two heat settings, if I get it on high, two, and put it like that, I will burn a hole through this. Okay, so use common sense.
Yeah.
Work up to it. You can't undershrink this stuff.
Okay.
So it's better to go at areas slowly and see the effect rather than just go at them point blank and melt a hole.
Right.
Because that is a bad day, because then you've got to get involved in repairing or recovering and so forth. So, like I said, think before you shrink. I might trademark that. Think before you go at it really heavily with high heat. One other thing which we have is this device, the heat glove. Seems silly, but yeah, it's a glove. The idea is that you'll be using high heats with this. It's nice to have that glove, because what you can do then is push down. Sometimes you need to chase a wrinkle out or chase a bubble out. So this is really handy for that, because this gets, I say red hot, but enough to cause discomfort when you're pushing down. Also really good is a wet wipe, a bunch of wet wipes, because what happens is there you can push down with those and they cool the covering quicker. So not essential, but the glove is the one that if I was gonna pick any tool, it's the between the wet wipe and this, I'd choose this. Process, there isn't really one. You can start at one corner and work your way. Don't be surprised if you have to go at an area more than once. That's quite common. You won't just do it in one hit. Time-wise, it takes a lot longer. Even the amount of times I've shrunk, it takes a lot longer than you think to do it properly. I mean, if I rushed it, I could probably do this plane in 20 minutes. but if I want to do it right, I'd allocate an hour for the first shrink. Because I want to sit and work, and like I say, you can't undershrink. You can overshrink, you can overheat, and you can damage it. It's better just to work at it enjoy it. It does make a huge difference to the way the plane looks. Right now, it's not, I wouldn't say beautiful, so hopefully we'll show you a before and after.
Yeah.
It's worth that time, you know, spent. And remember, just that one rush and making that piece of film shrink too much or burning a hole, it's going to cost you hours. So
yeah, that's true.
It's worthwhile taking your time.
Okay, perfect. Well, what we'll probably do is we'll show a lot of the key points. We're going to let this camera run the whole time, but we figure you're not going to watch the whole thing. Maybe you will. So I think we're going to get everything plugged in, get Ali in position. We're just going to start rolling with it and kind of see what we gather. So stay tuned, and we might pop in with some more info if we run across it.
So plug the iron in. It's come to temperature. Now, temperature. There's not just a one temperature deal on these heat sealing irons. They're variable. Check with the manufacturer's recommendations on temperature. Different films react differently to heat and require different temperatures to adhere and to shrink. We use UltraCote, genuine UltraCote, and that has, you can find online a manual for that, which will give you set temperatures. Whilst a thermometer is great to get if you really want to be precise, it doesn't have to be that accurate, but certainly when you're learning, it's a good thing to have. I cover and shrink so much, I know that what my temperature positions are, and it's twofold. One for sealing and tacking edges is about the 9 o'clock position on my dial there, and then for shrinking on the iron, it's all the way up, cranked all the way up. Now the reason why that is because I've got the sock. The sock is a heat barrier between the metal base, which has an element inside, and the covering. If I didn't have the sock, I know I've got to back down. So 9 o'clock is about my max position for shrinking, and then I go to around about 7 o'clock for tacking. Be careful, it's different for every iron. So don't just go at it all gung-ho and say, oh, Ali said 9 o'clock, so go like that, and you burn a great big hole in the side of your plane. Read the instructions. There's hints and tips on little checks you can do using offcuts of covering to see how it reacts. So yeah, again, under shrink. It's better to do too cool first and build up to it than too hot and do damage. Now, first stage, before I start going at it with a heat gun and trying to get all the main wrinkles out, is a process where I seal the edges. Now, that's done at the factory, but don't always assume it's completely 100% done. Because what happens is, if they don't seal the edge completely, when you go at it and shrink, it's a plastic that basically contracts with heat. If it's not sealed, you can sometimes pull the edges off. So the edge here, for instance, if it wasn't sealed, could pull off this, roll off this edge, which is a bad day. These little edges here, these little trim stripes here, if they're not applied 100% correctly at the factory, then they could, with heat, distort. Now I can feel these are brilliant. These are really, really well adhered. But you know what? It costs you very little time to just get the iron with the sock and just run it over. So all it takes, is just to make sure the edges are sealed. See this little wrinkle here? If I went at that with high heat, my worry is it might roll off that. So just for the sake of peace of mind, I spend 20 seconds with the iron just sealing that edge. Now I'll come back to that later on with the heat gun with the knowledge and the faith that it's sealed, okay? And if you can do that on all the edges, then you know what? It's time well spent. So take that time initially. Quick rundown on how the process works. This plastic covering has adhesive applied to the inside edge, and that's heat activated. So at room temperature, that adhesive is cured. You use the device, whether it be the iron or the heat gun, to activate that adhesive and stick it in place. So bear that in mind when you're working. If I go at this with high heat now, the glue becomes tacky and I can lift it up, but let it cool and it sticks. So that's basically what I'm doing. It's just running the edges, making sure everything's down tight before I start applying high heat. If you feel any resistance, you're pushing too hard. This thing just wants to float across the top. You're not pushing down and forcing it in place. First, use the heat to activate the adhesive, and then light pressure. Use the glove, use your finger pressure. Don't use the iron as the pressure point, because what's happening is it's the heat that activates the glue. So it's almost like a catch-22. I want that piece of covering to stick. I'm going to use this device. This device makes that piece of covering not stick. So you know, just be mindful of that as you work. Just go across these edges here. As you can see, I'm paying no attention to getting rid of the big wrinkles at this stage. I'm just trying to get the covering down nice and tight. Quick focus here. All the irons will come with this little heat stand. I still use a heat mat as well. Remember, if I just put this on my foam protective mat, it's gonna burn a hole in the mat and ruin this sock. So whenever you can work, make sure you've got that little device at hand. And yeah, take your time, work around, seal the edges. If you see any loose edges, I mean, typically this is all pretty good. I can't see any loose edges to show you, but I'll have a quick look. There's one slight edge here. I don't know if the camera will pick it up, but on that I can just feel a rolled edge there. See my fingernail picking up on it? That's the sort of thing. I mean, it's stuck further up, but it's a good example. Just roll the iron across that, push it down, and just seal that edge. There you go, that edge is down, now down tight. Same with these stripes, just make sure, particularly the ends where it's like wafer thin almost, you just want to put heat on that now, just to make sure it's stuck down before we go at it with high heat. Edges, I'll have a look at, see if there's any edges. We took the cowling off this, the reason being, there's covering underneath the cowling, so if we left the cowling on, we wouldn't shrink that bit, so I can just go at this now with the heat iron. Just using low heats, low pressure, just gliding across, taking my time. I could probably do with a little more. And it's one of those trial and error things. You build up to it, you feel like, okay, I can see that's pretty cool. I've upped the heat a little bit. And you'll learn what temperature your iron works best at, and your covering as well. Because don't forget, not all ARFs are covered in genuine UltraCote. There are, for want of a better word, copies. There are equivalents which aren't as heat resistant or as heat tolerant, so it's definitely better to creep up on the covering as far as heat. I've seen some of the lesser materials where people have gone at them with the heats that they're used to working with UltraCote or MonoKote, which are the premium covering brands. Put those on the lesser brands, just shrinks a hole or peels an edge off. So just be careful. If you're not sure whether it's genuine UltraCote, which all Hangar 9 planes are, or genuine MonoKote, which the top flight planes were, take your time. Okay, as I touched on the previous video, make sure the edges are sealed. I've got an edge here which feels really well stuck down, but it's gonna cost me very little time just to brush the iron across that with the sock and make sure it is. Same with these edges here. If I go at these too hard or too aggressively with heat, they might roll back. So just spend a little bit of time making sure those edges are happy. And then it's on to the more serious stuff of the heat gun. Now, heat gun is probably my primary tool for big areas, getting big areas of wrinkles out. Reason being is it's less localized, it's more even as well. The heat iron, you do run a risk of pressing too hard and almost pushing a wrinkle down, especially if it's a big wrinkle. You're using that heat to shrink it first. So, two settings. Low and high, you know what? I don't think I ever use the low on genuine UltraCote and MonoKote, but as I said in the previous video, sneak up on it. If you're not sure whether it's genuine MonoKote or UltraCote, start with the low setting. You don't want to go at a covering and then shrink it too much and burn a hole. So, still, let's have a look. So, for continuity's sake, I would say start at a tip or start at a base and work your way along. But for the sake of this video, I'm just going to localize to this area here, which has a whole bunch of wrinkles. It's not rocket science. It's just apply heat. You'll learn with the distance, how far or how close. Again, a bit like the temperature on the iron, sneak up on it. Don't just go right next to it. Genuine UltraCote and MonoKote is very, very difficult to burn a hole into, but you can do it. You know, I'm not setting that as a challenge. I don't want to see pictures of everyone's planes with little round holes in them. But you can, if you go right next to it. The same as if you hold it too far away, then you're not going to see any shrinkage. So play with it. And you'll see, it's very visual. You can see the wrinkles disappearing. So we'll let the gun come to heat or come to temperature. Try not to stay in an area too long, come back to it. Remember, the heat is activating the adhesive,
and then it shrinks the actual covering. Think of the process in which it happens. It doesn't shrink and then activate the adhesive. The adhesive activation is the first step and the shrink is the second step. That's right, the glove comes in handy because that surface is quite hot right now. So if I went at that with bare skin, it would be a little bit uncomfortable. But you can see, when I go back now where I missed on the leading edge, didn't get all the wrinkles out. It really is as simple as that. If you have the right tools and the right approach to it, it's not difficult at all. Patience is one of those things. Headphones is good at this stage. I generally, at home when I'm working in my workshop, headphones always come on because it's a bit mind-numbing at times where you're just continually trying to shrink the same sort of areas. So yeah, you see the distance, I'm probably what, 1.5-2 inches away, depending on the area, depending even on the color. Some different colors of covering react differently. So big open areas like this between the ribs are super easy. Everyone can do those. It's the trickier areas or the sheeted areas like this or around the light. Go easy around areas like this where the covering is cut away, because if I go and hit that with high heat, there's a very high likelihood it will pull that back, which is unsightly. I mean, it's not going to cost you an aeroplane, but it's horrible to see a bit of exposed edge. So yeah, be wary when you come to edges like that. And you can go back as well. If you're worried about edges like that, go back with the heat iron. The gun is a bit less, gentle when it comes to applying heat. You know, it can be a bit more aggressive. So yeah, don't be scared of going, okay, I'm gonna leave that wrinkle for a little bit later on and tackle that with the iron. But for the big areas like this, the heat gun's the best. And you don't have to have the wings on the plane. We've done this for the video, purpose of the video. Normally when I'm shrinking stuff of my own, I have the separate components just because it's easier to handle. So don't feel like it's got to be actually fitted to the plane. The good news is it's super rewarding. I know it's a bit mind-numbing, as I said, and boring, but when you get it done and you take a plane that was covered in wrinkles and you're finished and it's all sort of tight and taut and smooth, it's like, yeah, sense of achievement's pretty high.